So although haplodiploidy makes it easier for the ants and bees to form eusocial societies than other species, haplodiploidy itself is not essential for the evolution of eusociality. There are organisms like termites that have colonies that are every bit as complicated as those of ants and bees, but these are diploid, just like normal insects. You have a queen who's this ridiculous egg factory with masses of workers going out and doing the jobs. You have some that, in this case, they have kind of a nozzle on the end of their face, and they squirt enemies with a poison to chase them off. Other workers may have big mandibles. Others are focused entirely on tending to the nest. So you have a very complex society of termites, just like you do with the ants and the bees. Now, amongst mammals, there's even a eusocial species, and this is the naked mole rat. The naked mole rat has a queen who's really mean to all the other individuals in her colony, but they respond to her kind of abusive behavior as workers. So you have some naked mole rats who do nothing except go out and forage, so they look for food, they gnaw off the bottoms of things that are like turnips and bring the food back to the queen and the babies. There are others that tend to the tunnels underneath the soil. There are others that are big that are there to fight off snakes that might want to invade. So you have, again, a division of labor, and you have one reproductive female in the whole colony. But naked mole rats, like all other mammals, have XXXY sex determination. They're diploid, and yet they've evolved this extreme form of cooperation, eusociality. So, what we want to think about is, what are the ecological circumstances that might predispose some species towards eusociality and not others? And so these are often referred to as ecological constraints. And if a young animal is unable to breed successfully on its own because the world is crowded already, there's as many houses full of people as possible in the neighborhood, its own best option may often be to act as a full-time helper. Well, I can't start my own family yet, so I might as well stick around and help mom and dad to produce more offspring. So in that case, you literally have nothing to lose. Your chances of reproducing on your own are very, very low, so the costs of staying home and acting as a helper are essentially zero. So C is essentially zero, because direct reproduction is impossible. And so this makes it quite likely that if you've got a close relative that you can help, you'll often have situations where you should be nice and help out your parents, your siblings, if they've already got an established breeding territory and there's no more openings for you. Now, there's a very nice example of this shown in a study of fairy wrens down in Australia that was published a few years ago, where you have, this is not a beehive, now we're representing the territories of different families of fairy wrens. And in the fairy wrens, you have the breeding couple here, so there's the mother, there's the dad, and then there's also a helper. And in this particular species, there's very high female mortality. So there's a shortage of females in the population. There's even a shortage of young females in the population. And so every adult female has a husband, and when they have offspring, their sons are often left with no opportunity to mate for themselves. So they stick around as helpers. And so all the helpers in the society are sons. Every daughter that grows up is easily able to start her own family somewhere else, but there's so few females in the overall population, the excess sons stay around and they work as helpers. And they do help. They bring food back to the nest, feed the nestlings, so mom and dad now are getting better success by having their adult son sticking around and helping them. Now, the idea of the ecological constraints can be tested by removing the husbands or the dad from each one of these families. Okay, so now you have all these helpers and there's opportunities. They don't want to stay at home and mate with mom, but there's a shortage of breeding males all over the place. And so these males can now quickly move to a new territory, mate with an unrelated female, and start their own family. And this is exactly what happened in this study, where all the breeding males were removed temporarily with nets, and then the scientists could see what happened, and lo and behold, those sons left mom and stopped helping her with her current brood to went off to start their own family within something like a half an hour after dad disappeared. So these guys really were held in place by the shortage of breeding opportunities for themselves. And they then went off to become breeders as soon as they possibly could. So that's a classic case of ecological constraints. Now, naked mole rats, which is the only eusocial vertebrate that has been discovered so far, you have a queen naked mole rat and you have all those abused workers who slavishly tend to the needs of their mean mama. They live underground in a very harsh desert. They live in deserts of East Africa, and they cannot survive outside the tunnel system of their colony. And so it's almost impossible for a young naked mole rat to leave home and go somewhere else and start a new colony. All the colony systems with the tunnels are already occupied, the habitat is saturated, and it's almost impossible to get from one to another. So, as a result, these young naked mole rats often don't go anywhere. And the king, as it were, the breeding male for the queen, is usually somebody from within her own family. Okay? So you have these naked mole rats who are habitually breeding within the family. And this sets up an interesting genetic consequence. And let's go to the Simpsons for a very interesting biology lesson here. If you're familiar with the show, you may remember the slack-jawed yokel, Cletus, and his wife, Brandine. Now, what's important to recognize about this particular example is that Cletus and Brandine are themselves full siblings, yet they got married and they have a whole bunch of children, okay? Now, this means that any children that Cletus has by Brandine, he's not only the father, but he's also their uncle, because he's Brandine's brother, okay? And also, Brandine is the mother and the aunt of Cletus's kids. So they're related to their offspring by 3/4, okay? And that would just be with one generation of close-in breeding. Generation after generation, in a species like naked mole rats, the coefficient of relatedness gets really quite high indeed. Once again, making it very likely that that inequality of R being greater than C over B will be met in this very unusual species. So, kinship allows reproduction by proxy for individuals who would otherwise never succeed on their own.